Okay, everybody who's now attending can see us.
So Fabrice, if you go there.
So this topic. Okay.
So on the left, Fabrice, where there is the camera.
For all of the people attending the webinar, behind the scenes, sorry, we've accidentally started the webinar, so you're going to see us rooting around under the bonnet. So please do have a cup of tea or something. We'll be starting in about 10 minutes. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm in camera now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's strange. I don't see why it's not showing.
I've got it in microphone, that's why you can hear me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And camera is not showing.
That's strange. I do see it on camera.
Yeah, so it's like it's not being enabled or authorized or something like that.
I do have it there.
It looks like a faulty installation. So it means that cannot be seen, right? We have.
So Fabrice, in the app, in the GoToMeeting app.
You see my screen, right?
I can see your screen, yes.
Okay.
So if you go to the icon on the deck doc, of the GoToMeeting. So go there, go to the app. No, but left click it.
Right click?
No, left.
Left, yeah. Preferences. Webcam. You see, he wants me to go to the system preference, but there is not there. So.
Ah, okay. So left click the GoToMeeting app. Okay, and then on the top you should see file edit options, view webcams.
Yeah.
So what are the options that you see?
In options, I got attendee can raise hand, view attendees can ask questions. The webcam, you always send me back to the security options.
No, but hang on, don't you see something like this? I sent it by email. Like on the very top, when you see,
I've got
the
file edit view options.
Can you see another? Okay, so in webcams?
In webcam, it sends me back to the security thing, which where the application is not listed.
Don't you see like preferences there in webcams preferences?
Yeah, there is, but it also meets security and privacy. Share my webcam. To share webcam, grant camera access in security and privacy preferences. And then open system preferences. It brings me there where I don't have the the application.
So what happens if you click on the lock? So in this security and privacy, what happens if you click on the lock?
On the lock, at the time. Okay, so now it's unlocked. And how can I add an application? Okay, maybe if I put it there. So it's unlocked, but how can I put this GoToMeeting there?
Okay, so it says that if the camera is not, if the not listed in the camera, we should go to the GoToMeeting preferences. So click on the app.
Yeah, click on the app.
There on the panel on the very top where it says GoToMeeting. Yeah, on the left corner.
Yeah.
There should be about GoToMeeting and preferences. So there. And there should be a webcam tab. And here you should be. You should ask to allow it.
It's the same. It's always good to see the preferences. And now go back. I mean, do you see now the webcam now from the tablet? We've got the webcam from the tablet.
Yeah, it is working now.
But is it possible to have the video from the webcam from the tablet displayed with the PowerPoint from the computer?
That's what we're seeing now. We're seeing you on camera and we're seeing your desktop.
Okay, so as long as this works, let me put this full screen.
Ladies and gentlemen who have been watching us fiddle around with this, thank you very much for your patience. We will be starting the lecture in a couple of minutes. Normally we do this behind the scenes, but some fool, that was me, accidentally hit the start broadcast button. So you got to watch what we usually do in secret behind the scenes. So we will be starting in a couple of minutes. So if you want to grab a cup of tea or something, we'll be getting on with it.
At least we are dressed. I've got to change privacy on back, so this should go right. Okay.
Yeah. Fantastic.
Thank you. So we cannot share gossips now because we are broadcasting.
We always gossip about very professional things, usually about physics, like physics all the time, constant.
My talk is pretty much about gossips anyway, so.
Yeah. We've got about double the number of people who are already here registered, so I'm hoping for them to arrive shortly. I'll take a moment to explain to people already here. If you've not used the GoToWebinar system before, in the corner you'll see a little panel, hopefully, that has appeared on your screen. If you click on that arrow, a whole panel appears, and on that you'll see a questions tab, and that's where you'll be able to send in questions. The plan is to take those questions at the end. You can write the questions at any time during the presentation, but then Camillo will read them out to Fabrice at the end. Actually, I think Fabrice can see them as well, can't you? Bear in mind, Camillo and Fabrice, you need to pop out your questions pane in order to be able to see the questions. So if you pop that out, you'll be able to see them coming in.
Okay.
Equally, if anybody has any tech problems, if you send that in, we'll try and get that sorted as well. However, the usual thing is to turn it off and on again. That seems to sort out most of them. So I'm going to disappear now and hand over to Camillo, who is going to host us this evening for the lecture from Fabrice. I'm going to still be here in the background if anyone needs me there.
Okay.
Cheers.
Okay, so I would like to welcome you all to this session, the second session of this year series of lectures of the sponsored by the Institute of Physics at the University of Wolverhampton. Today we have Professor Laussy, who is the Director of Studies of Physics at the University of Wolverhampton, who is going to speak about the Nobel Prize, this year Nobel Prize in Physics, which was given to the topic of cosmology. And so Fabrice, before coming to Wolverhampton, he made a sort of tour around Europe. So he came to England, to Sheffield and Southampton, then he spent some time in Germany, then Spain, and during these years, whenever the Nobel Prize was awarded to a topic that was related to his research interest, he was giving a seminar explaining the connections between the Nobel Prize and the research. But with the occasion of these IOP lectures, he's now giving one of these Nobel Prize lectures every time, so every year. So as I said, this one is going to be about cosmology. So very interesting, very far apart from our research interest, but nonetheless very interesting. So Professor Laussy, if you want, you can start the lecture now.
Thank you, Camillo. So it's my great pleasure to be here with you, and to be here technically, no, because I'm in my home, in my office, but to be with you to speak about this year's Nobel Prize. So as Camillo said, it's something that is kind of a tradition in our group, because every year we ask someone to speak about Nobel Prize. And so let me see. Okay, sorry. And this year has been attributed to these three people, Roger Penrose, Reinhard Genzel, and Andreas Geis, and we are going to speak about it, even though it's not the kind of physics that we do on a day-to-day basis. But we can always relate one's research to any fields of physics, actually. I will not do it this year because there's a lot to speak about. I could tell you about our actual research, which is on polariton, is related ultimately to these black holes and these kind of things. So this is last year's Nobel. Let us first read the official denomination, why they got the Nobel Prize for. So for Roger Penrose, it's half of the Nobel Prize, and it was, that's the official name, we're going basically to decipher what it means, for the discovery that black hole formation is a robust prediction of the general theory of relativity, the bit circumvallated way to put things, and we'll see why people take these kinds of precautions. And then jointly, which means that the other half of the prize was given together to these two people for the same result, for the same work, which was for the discovery of a supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy. So basically, it's about black holes, the this year's Nobel Prize. But you see that for Genzel and Gaze, the Nobel denomination doesn't speak of black hole. It speaks of supermassive compact object instead. In fact, if you go to see what the Genzel and Gaze on their website or in their own way to describe their research, they are not so precocious. They mention black hole, but they are not neither completely asserting. They say that they find the black hole beyond any reasonable doubt, or they say that their observation is compatible to the state of the art of our current knowledge only with a black hole. So it cannot be something else. But it means that it's not a direct sighting. It's not a direct or explicit observation. It's like inferred. That's why there is this difference. So that was the, we are going to discuss that in more detail. Yeah. And the point is that half of my lecture, more or less, is not on the Nobel Prize of Physics this year. It's about the Nobel Prize itself, because I like to speak a lot about the history of science or the social aspects that are involved in the Nobel Prize. It's really interesting. And yeah, this was the topic of last year, which surprisingly, I mean, most people didn't expect that. I think it was on similarly, the same topic on cosmology, to Peebles, Mayer, and Kellogg. And it was the same thing. It was people got half the prize for some very sophisticated, arcane theoretical developments. And then the other half went to two experimentalists to make much more straightforward observations. So it was kind of a bit symmetric from last year's prize. And you can see here, you can see me last year giving the talk and explaining the Mayer and Kellogg's technique to find this exoplanet. It was for Peebles, it was for the cosmological model of the Big Bang. And for the two others, it was the way they observe exoplanets, and they were using this this redshift, so this Doppler effect, which is a well-known effect that we study at the early years of university, that says that the frequency of a wave from something which is in relative motion is changing its frequency. So there was a very British example there. Okay, so a few statements about the prize itself. So as you know, it concerns these disciplines: physics, chemistry, physiology or medicine, literature and peace. And it is bequest at the in the honor of Nobel, who, the story says, happened to found one day by mistake an obituary, the announce of his death in a newspaper. And when he read what people were telling about him, so he was the guy who invented the dynamite, he was so upset that this is the memory that people will have of him, that he decided to give all his fortune to honor this prize, this beautiful things that is science and advancing the knowledge and the state of the art of all these fields. And if we look at his will, that's the will there in the original form, and that's the one written in text. So I want to see exactly what he had in mind in his will when he wanted to do that. So I'll read on my computer, which is there. If you look at the fourth line, he says that it should be conferred to the people who the preceding year, the year before when you won the prize initially, who has conferred the greatest benefit on mankind. And let's look at the one on literature, because this one is particularly interesting. That's at the end of the text. He says that for the literature, it should be for the most outstanding work of an idealistic tendency. It's a quite precise understanding of what should be rewarded in literature. More facts about the prize itself. So the ceremony is on December the 10th. That's when Alfred Nobel died, this time for real. It is delivered in Oslo for the Peace Prize and in Stockholm for the other prize. This bit is interesting. There are between, well, a few hundred secret nominees. So they are secret, but for some finite amount of time, which means that eventually you can know if you have been nominated for the Nobel Prize, even if you didn't get it. And this is also very important. It leads to a lot of problems and puzzles to solve. You can only have for each prize at most three people, not more than three people. And configuration is that everybody gets one third, or you get one half like this year, and the other two share the remaining thing. So no more than three. There is also that you should be alive at the time when you get the prize. It cannot be given posthumously. The amount of money that you get is $1 million, more or less. That's the interest of the Nobel Foundation. That's the money he had to put in the bank, the interest of which pays this thing every year. Something which is interesting is to see how much money this Nobel Foundation actually has. It's kind of modest, actually. It's something like less than $100 million. If you compare to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, for instance, who has several billion dollars, if they would do the same, instead of $1 million, people would get several hundred million dollars every time they win the prize. But of course, they don't do it, you don't do it for the money, right? So you get the money, you get this gold medal as well, and you get a diploma, the three things that you get. And each diploma, I mean, for some reason, the public doesn't know too much about them. We don't get to see them. I mean, of course, you can find them, but it's not something that we otherwise find. They are piece of art. There is an artist that specifically writes or draws something which is related to the finding. So we've got this one, for instance. That's my mask. I don't know if you see the mask. Yeah. We've got this one there, which is for the Coasterly-Starless transition, where we've got this transition between chaos and ordered phase that happens with these vortices that bind in the superfluid phase. It's a very beautiful document. Before we turn to physics specifically, let's have a quick look at the other prizes, because that's interesting to see how everything fits together, the humanities fits together. So in literature, here I put you some of the awardees, some of the people that are very famous. So you recognize Steinbeck, Beckett, this is Camus. I'll put my mask so that we go through them. This is Bernard Shaw. Shaw is interesting because he initially refused the Nobel Prize. He said that he was ready to forgive Nobel to have invented the dynamite, but that he could never forget someone to have done something like the Nobel Prize, which means to give money or to make this pretense that there is someone who did a good job better than the others. So he refused, but his wife convinced him that it was not for him, it was for Ireland, he should accept the prize. And he eventually accepted the prize, but didn't take the money. So there is some element of nobility in there. We've got Kipling there, Garcia Marquez, of course, Hemingway, this is Anatole France, Saramago. So the list could carry on like this. It means to show that the most important writers, contemporary writers, since 1901, since the time there is a Nobel Prize awardee, are there. But not all of them. In literature, for instance, you see that we don't have Tolstoy, or we don't have George Orwell or Chekhov. Actually, a lot of Russian people are missing. And it's supposed that there is this kind of antagonism between Sweden and Russia. We don't have people like Vonnegut. I don't know. A lot of very important people are missing. And that's what is interesting in Nobel Prize, more than the people who got it, is the people who didn't get it. And so there is Camus here, but there is no Jean-Paul Sartre, for instance. But Jean-Paul Sartre is because he himself refused the prize for good, like Shaw, but he just didn't take it. The story says that he also changed his mind later because he needed the money and he wanted to ask for the money, but they told him it was too late and he never get nor the prize nor the money. There's also, as far as the money is concerned, there is also the case of the German scientist that during Nazi Germany, they were forbidden. There was a decree that forbidden every German citizen to accept the Nobel Prize. And some German people later got the Nobel Prize that they were forbidden to take during the war. But they got the prize, but not the money. Yeah, they got the medal and and everything, but not the money. Controversies, because as I said, there is to make it interesting, there is a bit an aspect of gossips in this talk. So this is Nobel Prize for 2016. Bob Dylan, and that's interesting because Bob Dylan is not a writer. Of course, some can consider he's a poet, but then that still removes, now in our list of before, is missing a lot of people, right? If we would put someone like Bob Dylan. But the injustices or the omissions or the scandals that you can find in the literature prize are nothing at all to do as compared to the Peace Nobel Prize. This one is the really interesting one because there it happens, it's the one which is most criticized, where you find really the most fanciful nominations and awardees and kind of things. So we'll not go into details because of time mainly, also because it's recorded. The point that when something is recorded, you have to be careful, you cannot make any strong statements. So I'll keep it to that. I'll show you these two famous people. At least the one on the right is very famous. This is Gandhi, of course. That's the person with whom we associate this peace, right? That's what Einstein was saying about Gandhi. Was seeing his role model for generations to come. He, as you might know, certainly know, he didn't got the Nobel Prize for peace. Yeah, he was not in the list. Someone on the left got it. This is Henry Kissinger. This is also famous because when you know what Kissinger did, I put you here one quote from somebody else. I will not read it this time. And of course, Bourdin is much less famous than Einstein, right? But that also tells you the kind of people who have to make comments on the people who got the prize. So it's quite interesting that you would get the prize for Kissinger, but not Gandhi. Other cases that are notable in the Peace Nobel Prize. So there is, in 2007, it was given to Al Gore. And people like to ridicule it by saying that he got it. It was the first time a Nobel Prize was given for a PowerPoint presentation. Because that's what Al Gore did, presumably. he got the Nobel Prize for his for making the public sensible to the climate change. But what did he actually do for climate change? What he did is to go and speak about it. So a bit surprising for Nobel, Peace Nobel Prize. 2009, Barack Obama. This one was so surprising that even Obama didn't expect it at all to get the prize. But he still got it anyway. The second Nobel Prize I was refused, interestingly, was for peace. One for was for literature by Sartre. The second was for peace by Le Duc Tho, the Vietnamese guy who said that he wouldn't accept the prize despite his effort because peace was not actual in Vietnam. And indeed, it was kind of good thing to do. So Obama didn't go so fast to refuse the prize. And 2012, the European Union, which is also very interesting concept or even choice. Who knows, maybe the Earth planet will get the Peace Nobel Prize at some point. But let's go now closer to our own disciplines. We'll pass by chemistry. Chemistry is almost physics already. Start to get into the more respectable prizes because in chemistry and physics, to the best of my knowledge, they are highly respected. Everybody thinks that all the awardees are worthy of it. The Peace Nobel Prize, for instance, it's much more criticized. It's not so serious, I would say. For chemistry, so there are a lot to discuss as well, but we'll keep it to this one. This is the most famous thing about chemistry. This is the table of elements. On the right, you've got the father of this table, Mendeleev, and he didn't get the Nobel Prize, the chemistry Nobel Prize, despite his nomination, his finding, yeah? He almost got it in 1906. In 1906, he was short of one vote to get the chemistry Nobel Prize. But he went instead to the fluorine, which is this element there, this one that we got over there. Well, it didn't go to fluorine itself, of course. It's not like the Peace Nobel Prize, I said, chemistry. It's a serious thing. So it went to the person who discovered the fluorine, who is Moissan, a French chemist. So another funny choice for this year. And now let's go to physics. Here we spend more time because that's what we are doing in Institute of Physics. We are speaking about physics. So we'll go into more details. Starting with a list of all the nominees. So we are missing one of this year, 2020, Penrose and the two colleagues. And here you got the most famous of them. Everybody knows them. There are also Nobel Prize there, but I'm pretty sure you would find it difficult to name them. And I want to discuss this picture. This photo is one of my favorite. There is a lot of things to say whenever we got the pictures. We are very lucky nowadays that we've got pictures or photos of these famous people, very clever, intelligent people that did a lot, and we can have a peek at their relationship in this way. Something you cannot do for Newton, for instance. Or think about Hooke, we don't even have, not even painting yet, because Newton had all of them destroyed. But look at this picture, it's really nice. So you might recognize, I'm trying to find my mouse here. Okay, you might recognize Dirac, that's Heisenberg and Schrodinger. They are on the train station of Stockholm to get in 1933, if you check the date there. To take their Nobel Prize. Actually, in 1932, you see that Heisenberg got the Nobel Prize first, and 1933, it was Dirac and Schrödinger. But at this time, the life was much more relaxed, things were going slower, so they were giving the prize for each year, but they were awarding it in different times. So they went together, all together, to get the Nobel Prize. And this is a very nice picture because it tells you a lot about the different personalities of the scientists involved. These three women, by the way, are the two of them are the mothers of Dirac and Heisenberg. They came with their mother, so that already tells you a lot about them. And there is the wife of Schrödinger. Also, interestingly, they all look the same. I don't know which one is the wife and which one is the mother. But why is interesting this picture? Because if you know a bit of the development of the field of quantum mechanics, you know that there is a lot of antagonism, in particular, between these two people, between Heisenberg and Schrödinger. They were kind of not personal enemy, but almost a lot of competition. They developed competing or alternative version of quantum mechanics. And they have very different styles. So you see this flamboyant Schrödinger that came with the tie and this Bavarian art fit, and then you've got the embarrassed Heisenberg on the side. So really a nice picture to look at. This one, a very interesting picture as well. It's the first Nobel Prize, Röntgen. We could take all of them one after the other, and there's something to say about each and every one of them. But let's take only at the one that are most symbolic. So the first Nobel Prize in physics. This is Röntgen, and this is why or what for he got the Nobel Prize. His wife. So not the full wife, but the hand more specifically. So you have all seen this picture. And this is the imaging of the bones that Röntgen made of his wife with his X-ray, discovered the X-ray, so got the Nobel Prize for that. And here it was actually fitting with the will of Nobel, which was to award the prize to the person who deserved it most, who advanced, who did the best progress for the benefit of mankind. Of course, it's very important, radiography. And this was done very early on. We don't have to wait several years to give the prize, and it was really useful. But look again at the picture. I mean, this is interesting, this picture. You can imagine Röntgen calling his wife in the kitchen and tell her, come on, darling, I want to try something. Very beautiful picture of Röntgen there as well. Other famous picture, this is of the Solvay conference, where you got a lot of very famous people. I don't know who is this one on the left, but this is Planck, for instance. You got Rutherford with beaming in the middle. You recognize the nice young Einstein on the side. But again, looking at the picture, where is the tension? Where is the interest in this picture? This is the center. Yeah? This is Poincaré and Marie Curie. And Poincaré, this is another of this big injustice of the Nobel Prize. He never got awarded the Nobel Prize. But as I told you at the beginning, we can actually consult the archives of the Nobel Foundation and see who nominated whom and for which reasons. So again, we're not going to the details, but Poincaré was almost got it. Yeah, he was at this to get the Nobel Prize, but didn't get it. And Poincaré, like Penrose this year, maybe didn't get it because his work was of a too mathematical nature. Poincaré, most people regard him as a mathematician, not as a physicist, which is also a bit the case about Penrose. Einstein, there's a lot to say about Einstein. The most famous thing, I mean, now this is the most common knowledge, is that he didn't get the Nobel Prize for relativity. Einstein got it for the denomination is for his services to theoretical physics, and especially for the discovery of the photoelectric effect. It was in 21 Einstein that he got the Nobel Prize. Interestingly, not only didn't get it for relativity, which you would expect for Einstein, either special or general, actually both of them would require a prize by itself, but this was explicitly discarded in the denomination. If you look at the detail of the summary of why you got the prize, they say that this excludes the work that you did on relativity until it will be confirmed. Yeah? So this is one thing that was very much that was very important in the early days of the Nobel Prize. And people were making it very important that it should have the experimental confirmation. You shouldn't award the prize on something which was just a theoretical hypothesis. And this is 1921. Yeah, you might know that Eddington, he observed this shift of the eclipse, this very famous experiment of Eddington that confirmed the general relativity with such accuracy that it even made the news in the New York Times. This was not regarded as evidence enough by the Nobel Committee to give the prize to Einstein for this. As well, this is 21, the date for the Nobel Prize of Einstein, but he actually got it in 22, because in 21, the Nobel Prize didn't give the prize. And then they changed their mind and it's okay, let's give it to Einstein anyway. So almost Einstein could have been skipped and not get a Nobel Prize, which if anything, he could have got easily two or three. Let's look at this person who got two Nobel Prize. We'll start with this picture. So as I told you, it's very nice to look at picture and try to see what we can find in them and relate it to the known anecdote or stories that write what is behind the picture. Here you have three famous people, Bardeen, Shockley, and Bratton. And what do we see here? We see someone in the center who is the boss, the guy who's in charge, sitting in a microscope and looking at this clumsy older guy who looks like maybe he's embarrassed, he made a mistake, and then there is this nerdish looking guy in the background. So again, a picture with a lot of tension, yeah? And the Nobel Prize for the Bardeen, Shockley, Bratton was for the transistor. That's what he's looking at in the microscope. So why it's interesting, this picture, it is because, well, basically the work for the transistor, it comes from Bardeen, so the guy who's in the background, who made the theory. And Bratton was kind of the guy who was tweaking and making it work, the guy with the more technical skills to make the theoretical magic work. And Shockley was the boss of them, with a much more modest or secondary or if any contribution into the finding. But he got all the credit. He tried as much as possible to put these people in the background. And this, I believe, you can see it in this picture. If you look at the expression on Bardeen, he's really like upset or disappointed because Bratton maybe as much less pride and this kind of, well, this like this, who is playing along. But shockingly, we sitting by the apparatus of Bratton, probably never went into this lab before. And you see the despise and contempt in the look of Bardeen. So very nice picture. You have this expression in all the other pictures that we know about this encounter. So it's the same again. You can see that there's so much cold and anger in there. And why it's interesting, why I choose this as opposed to any of the other possible anecdotes, is that Bardeen was so upset with Shockley that he decided to change affiliations, change topic, and he attacked another topic, which is the problem of superconductivity. He paired himself with two other colleagues again. So this is Bardeen in the middle, and I'm much older. He paired himself with Cooper and Schrieffer, and they solved the problem of superconductivity, which was the big problem of the time in solid state physics. And they explained why there was this sudden drop of resistivity in some metals if you lower the temperature. And this is the opposite of the previous collaboration where there was much tension and stolen credit. Here, this is the perfect example of the working scientific collaboration, because any of them, Bardeen, Cooper, and Schrieffer, they brought one piece of the puzzle of superconductivity, which was very difficult problem. Yeah? So Bardeen, he brought the interactions of the electron with the phonon lattice. Cooper brought the piece which was the Cooper pairing, that there is instability on top of the Fermi C. And Schrieffer explained how you make a condensate of Cooper pairs and that makes a superconductor. A lot of anecdotes as well. For example, Schrieffer went to jail because he killed someone driving drunk or things like that. The point is that Bardeen solving this problem was not the head of the collaboration, but he gave good credit to everybody, and everybody did something, including Bardeen himself, got the second Nobel Prize. And that's incredible when you think about it. Even Einstein couldn't get that. His contribution was so strong, so splendid, so fantastic in two different things, the superconductor transistor that powered the entire industry revolution that we get now with telecommunication, the computers, it's all based on transistor, and then solving superconductivity, which was the biggest puzzle of the time. And Bardeen kept so much despise for this whole problem that when he was tying up with Schrieffer and Cooper, they were finalizing the BCS theory of superconductivity, that's when he got the news that he got the Nobel Prize with the other guy. And he was very upset that he had to interrupt his work, his important work for him, the BCS work on superconductivity, to go back with his Shockley business. He used to say to the others, "Well, I'm sorry, guys, I've got to go to Stockholm to get the prize for the gadget." He was calling the transistor the gadget. Okay, so Bardeen, two Nobel Prize, some feats that even Einstein couldn't do, we imagine is the best physicist that we have. It indeed was a remarkable guy. So here, another twist, another interesting development. Bardeen was proven wrong, completely wrong, by this young guy, Josephson, who was not even a PhD student. He was someone who was still a student. And he made the prediction regarding the BCS theory that if you put two BCS superconductors separated by a tunnel, there would be oscillation between them because there would be a tunneling of Cooper pair through the tunnel junction. And Bardeen was very much opposed to this idea. He was saying it was not true, and Josephson started to follow Bardeen in all the conferences, and then whenever he would speak, he would stand up and ask the question and make a comment that how about the Josephson oscillation, how about my effect, and there grew a strong enmity between the two. There's this nice cartoon there where you see Bardeen was trying to oppose the young Josephson and making his supercurrent tunnel through. And of course, well, Josephson was proven right. The Josephson oscillation happens. You can have this contact between two superconductors that are separated by an insulator. It's actually very much used nowadays. You might have heard about these squids for very very precise technological component. And there is another famous thing, interesting thing to know about Josephson is that he got the Nobel Prize very young, even before he was a PhD. Yeah? There are people who got the Nobel Prize while they were PhD, like de Broglie, many people, several people. Josephson was the youngest. And something happened, it's not clear if it happened because of that. Yeah? Imagine you are the young guy, you are the theory, and you are fighting the physicist who got two Nobel Prize. And everybody, of course, was siding, you can imagine. Everybody was siding with Bardeen and telling the guy to shush him and it's enough now. But it was proven wrong eventually. That's the beautiful thing of science, is that when you're right, you're right. It's not for politics or a decision or a committee to decide. The experiment will decide. So it was proven correct eventually. So then he grew into this this illusion that however crazy was his idea, he would be correct. And he turned his interest into like very mystical things. Like now he's got a chair in Cambridge, he's a professor in Cambridge, Jason, and he's working on things like physical phenomena that explain telepathy or consciousness, how they are connected to quantum effect, this kind of thing. So most people regard him as crazy, and everybody tells him that, Brian, please try to get a grip on what you are saying, it's not serious. They do things like the cancel conference if Josephson would be invited there, because it's not serious to be seen with Josephson. But imagine having defeated Bardeen, the two Nobel Prize winner, the biggest name in the field at the time, and being proven right. So certainly that's some tricks on your mind. This one as well is interesting, this Penzias and Wilson Prize. These are these two people who built this giant detector of microwave, and they did it initially mainly as an engineering problem, yeah, to detect the microwave. But then they observed that they were finding in their detector, this big detector there, you see they even put little arcs there, they were finding some background noise. And this regardless of where they were orienting the thing, even when they were pointing this big thing towards the ground, they were finding the background noise. So then they knew it was not working. And then they found the solution. It was full of pigeon excrement inside. So they spent a full weekend cleaning it. And now they could resume their work. And still the noise was there. So they didn't understand anything. And they were about to dismantle this big thing when some theorists heard about this. And they asked them some detail about the signal. So here you got some name of this theorist, Bickison, Dickey, and Grove. And they understood that it was something that they had predicted themselves. It was the cosmic background, which was the remnants of the light. When light decoupled from matter in the early years of the universe, we got this cosmic background. And it should be observable at precisely the frequency that Penzias and Wilson were finding in their big Hornet detector. So actually, they were seeing something really fundamental. But they didn't know at all what it is. These people told them. And what happened is that Penzias and Wilson themselves got the prize. Right? Again, so you see the bias for the experimental evidence rather than the theoretical or understanding, yeah, or the understanding of what's going on. There is also on this picture, that's why I took it, is from the slide of my last year's talk. There is Peebles with was the student now on this picture. Even though he looks as old as the other guys, he was the young guy, and he got the Nobel Prize last year for this, for the cosmic background radiation. So at least this injustice has been fixed to some extent. He's also missing Alfer, who should have got the prize at least with Penzias and Wilson. Okay, other controversies in less details to win time, but that are worth mentioning. Fermi, Enrico Fermi, got the prize in 1938, so he deserved the prize. Of course, Fermi did many things, very important things, the golden rule, the theory of beta decay, all these things, electric interactions. But he got the prize for something that actually turned out to be wrong. So this was a mistake. Doesn't matter because he was deserving the prize anyway. 78, so that's the one we mentioned before. I like to put it in my list of mistakes. 79, Sudarshan was an Indian physicist. He was not awarded because of the rule that you can only get at most three people. He didn't get the prize when it was given to Weinberg, Lachaud, and Salam. And he certainly was part of the people who should be there. But the important thing, well, the interesting thing is that in 2005, it happened again. He didn't get it this time for another work, which is the one I was talking about previously, and I gave this talk in Sheffield on the quantum optics Nobel Prize. He didn't get it for the so-called, what people call in the field, the Glober-Sudarshan presentation, which should really be called the Sudarshan representation, because he was the first to come with the object, which is a way to represent a quantum state of light. He was the first to present it, and Glober initially opposed him. He told him that, well, it's not like this, you shouldn't use it. And then Glober changed his mind. And now it's mainly known as the Glober representation. Yeah. So Sudarshan got really upset at the end. I don't know how well he took the 79 incident, maybe with some philosophy, Indian philosophy. But in 2005, he actually wrote a very angry, upset letter to the New York Times to explain that it's a scandal. Top of that, in 2005, there were only two people. So he could have gotten it as well. So he made this thing, but of course, his letter was not even published. So imagine, poor guy. Yeah, you are always a sore loser when you lose. 2008, this one is interesting as well because it was given to the CKM. So CKM is for Kabibo, Kawasaki, and I don't remember very well the initial of everybody. I know Kabibo and I know Nambu, who are working on quantum field theory. The point is that this could have deserved two Nobel Prize in two different years. Yeah, but then they decided to take these two people there, K and M, and then the first one, Nambu. GL is not two people, actually. It's a compound name. I think he's an Italian guy. So there's two people there and three there. And then they make this strange combination of overlooking two guys from each of the two collaborations, which was a bit unfair, especially if it's probably an incident or a coincidence, but the two people who were dropped out, they were both of the same nationality. They were two Italian people. Nambu, the guy of the NGL part, was so offended by the choice that he asked the GL person to give the prize to give the talk at the ceremony on his behalf instead of him. So at least a nice gesture. The 2010 prize as well has been criticized a lot. The guy Novoselov prize on the graphene has been criticized a lot. I mean, every year's Nobel Prize is criticized by someone. Yeah, but it so happened that the 2010 is more criticized than on average. So it might be true that maybe their contribution has been a bit inflated. 2014 is also an interesting one. It's funny almost because these people, they got the Nobel Prize for the blue lead. Yeah. And Nick Oloniak, who made the lead. So not the blue one, not the one that emits blue light, the one that emits light. He didn't got the prize. That's funny, no? 2017, this one, so it's not the controversy, it's more like the problem that we've got with the Nobel Prize nowadays, is that the time of Einstein and the lone wolf that works on his own, and you can give the prize to one person alone, that's more and more difficult because nowadays science is a big collaboration. So this 2017 prize was given to three people. Kip Thorne certainly deserves the prize, very famous guy who did a lot of very important things. I don't know who is Weiss and Barish, but he's the director or whatever. But the point is that it was given for the LIGO collaboration. LIGO collaboration is literally thousands of scientists. These people, they publish papers. There is like three pages of names of everybody who is there. But because you can give the prize to only three people, then it's you have to pick people like that. And it starts to be a problem. And especially you see, because the Peace Nobel Prize we gave to the European Union. So why not giving the Physics Nobel Prize to the LIGO collaboration? It would be more fair maybe, but at least less interesting because we are human beings. Yeah? So we like that to put a face on a finding rather than a LIGO collaboration. And this one is my favorite one. It's my favorite controversy. 1915, the Nobel Prize was given, as you know, to the Bragg father and son. It's not Bragg father and son here, of course. This is Edison and Tesla. And they were the one who should have received the prize, but they were so enemies, they were hating themselves each other, and much more than Schrodinger and Heisenberg this time. This is really the bad enmity, that they both refused to get the prize if the other one would get it. Yeah, Tesla said, if Edison gets it, I'm out. And Edison, it is said, he preferred not to get the prize so that Tesla would not even get the money, because Edison was very wealthy, and Tesla was struggling with money. And Edison was so revengeful, biteful against Tesla that he wanted him to die in poverty. So he said, I would not get the prize and let Tesla die in poverty. So these two people didn't get the prize. They preferred the pride to the prize. And another famous controversy, and that brings us slowly, adiabatically, it will bring us to the topic of this year's Nobel. So this is the 74 Nobel Prize. Also very famous, very interesting controversy because it was given for their finding in radioastrophysics, Anthony Ewish. So what Ryle did, he was to find a way to put a lot of telescope in a different place. And these different telescopes, they behave collectively as if it was a big telescope that was covering the entire area. And Anthony Ewish, he observed something really interesting, which was a signal, very strange signal that he initially thought was a communication from extraterrestrial because it was too strong and too structured to be due to some optical, to some natural physical fundamental phenomena. He called it this thing LGM, for little green men. But the interesting thing is that himself, Ewish didn't believe it when he first saw the data. And the data didn't come from him. It came from this person, Jocelyn Bell Burnett. She is the one who first found the thing, who analyzed. He said that she was analyzing like 30 meters of paper every night to find this little signal. She brought it to Ewish, who was the boss. He disregarded it. He said, it's not true, it's a mistake, check again. She convinced him, he was correct, and she was not part of the prize. He went on it to write an Ewish. So another very famous controversy or scandal of the Nobel Prize. She's been very noble about it. Yeah? She explains with a lot of humility and modesty that, of course, the prize should honor the principal investigator because he's the one who is responsible. So he's the one to blame if there is a failure, but he's also the one to get the benefit if there is a success. So she doesn't look at it as a scandal, which is a really nice gesture. She got awarded the big prize more recently, and she gave all the money for women representation in science. A very noble soul, this dam. She's a dam, Bell Burnell. And now we leave the historical aspect of this gossipy and start to go into our business. So it was 78, now we're 93. Something which is related is the discovery of a pulsar, so this very massive compact object, got a Nobel Prize in 93, and there you see the first mention of the possibility to use this observation to study gravitation. And that's bringing us in the Nobel Prize of this year, which is for, as you know, it is for the black hole, the observation of the black hole. And here there's something interesting, is that the black hole has been observed very recently. It made the news of everywhere. I'm sure you've heard about it. Actually, last year, I bet, every year, I bet with someone on whom would get the Nobel Prize, I bet he would go to the observation of the Nobel Prize and he didn't get it, so I lost my bet. I always lost all my bets regarding Nobel Prize, by the way. And but this year, the Nobel Prize got to the black hole, but it didn't go to these people who made this observation. This is the direct this time, so not like the indirect observation of this year's Nobel Prize. This is the actual observation of Nobel Prize. Almost, because actually this is not something you see that is imaged on the camera directly. Yeah, they also used a lot of telescopes like Ryle technique that are delocalized and all collectively they behave like a big telescope. But more importantly, this image is reconstructed by this new technique now that is taking over everything that we do, which is machine learning and artificial intelligence. So it's like a neural network that assembled this image out of data that by itself doesn't show anything. So is it an explicit sighting? Well, a bit more than the indirect one that we are going to explain in a few slides, but still it's a bit indirect. Actually, that's the picture that everybody has seen. So that's the black hole. Here you've got the accretion disk around and what you see in between is the black hole. So we're going to discuss a bit more what is black hole. But with the data that accumulated over all this time, they actually made the movie. So I'm not sure you've seen the movie. That's the movie that's been reconstructed by the computer. So you see that it's black hole, it kind of rotates. These are the years. Yeah. Okay, so now I'll show you, first we'll speak about Penrose last because he's the guy who made the most difficult and the most sophisticated thing, like Peebles last year. We look at the more straightforward and easier to understand or to explain bits, which is the one from the two experimentalists, Genzel and Gens. And which, by the way, they are not working together, yeah? So they are both the principal investigator or research head of their respective group. One is in Germany. And this Reinhard Genzel is the head of the Max Planck Institute for Astrophysics, and the other is American. And this one comes from the German team, and I will show you. So that's a movie that I took from their website. It's very beautiful. That's a reconstruction of what they observed. So this is the Milky Way there, and now we are zooming into it. I hope this is playing on your screen. So they are looking into Sagittarius, which is where it's been identified since a long time ago, actually, that this is where there is the center of our galaxy, ours. So they're zooming there and they're looking with higher and higher precision. So I see on the screen, it's not too smooth. Go on their website and look at the movie because it's smooth and it's really fascinating to look at. It's mesmerizing. So we are zooming and looking at the very remote part. We are looking at the center of our galaxy. And we will see something which is going to appear now. So one breakthrough that they did is technical mainly. They have to find that's in the square. Okay, so we are zooming there. These are the stars. And now we are going to see the motion of these stars over several years, over 20 years or so. They are moving like this. Okay, I hope you see that on your screen. These are the stars that are moving at the center of a galaxy. So 65,000 light years away from us, very far. And this is the reconstruction of the thing. So it still looks like it's random swarms of firefly. But no, these are stars. And now that you've got the orbits, now you can start to see that actually it's very simple. What happens is just the familiar Keplerian orbit of the stars that gravitate around something. This something is the center of a galaxy. This is where there is the black hole. So that's the end of the movie. I can go there again. So that's what they saw. What they saw is the motion of the stars that are very far and they orbit like the planet or like any planet orbit around the sun in the solar system. So here it's not planet around the sun. It's a star against a much bigger star, a star which has million times the mass of our own star. So let's discuss a bit why they got the Nobel Prize. It's mainly for technical reason. Technical reason because they were able to see this, to image these stars. It's very far, it's very difficult. They couldn't do it in the optical range, for instance, because there is dust and there's a lot of absorption. So you don't see it by looking at the light. They have to look at microwave. And then the simple thing to do would be to use the Hubble telescope, for instance, because that's where you can get the nicer, neater image. But for some reason, over the amount of time which is needed, the movie that we see is over decades, yeah, over 10, 20 years. And you have to make constantly this this correction of where to look at and make a lot of very difficult tracking. So it's not possible to do it with satellites. So we have to do it with earthbound telescopes. And that's the technique that they use, which they didn't invent, they just apply. This is so-called adaptive optic. It consists in sending a signal with a laser to some object, and then you detect the emission of this thing, and you can correct for the perturbation of the atmosphere. And like this, you can, using this process of adaptive optic, you can compensate for the fact that you are not in empty space like the Hubble telescope, but you've got the full atmosphere, which is making your image scintillate or being twinkling, like you see the stars. And that's an animation of what you gain by using adaptive optics. So you see on the little square, you can actually resolve very neatly the star. So that's basically the input, is to be able to image this thing, which is easy. It is worth a Nobel Prize, right? Because it's incredible. We can see with such neatness so far away. There is another animation, which is the prediction. So what we have so far using the cake is the name of the telescope, and what they predict they will be able to see when they have their new toy in a few years' time, they will get a 30-meter telescope. So that's what we would see without any corrections. That's what they see now. And the last picture is what they will be able to see in the future. Let's have a look. This is incredible. They will be able to see with very neat precision things that are very far. So here we've got, in summary, the finding of the Nobel Prize for half of them, Reinhard and Andreas. In blue, there is the data from one of them. I don't remember which one. In red is the data for the others. What we find is simply the Keplerian orbit, which is the what Kepler found, yeah, that the planet orbits like an ellipse around the, not the sun in this case, around the so-called Sagittarius A star. The star is because it was exciting when we found this thing. And you see the grayish star here is independent evaluation of where the object is based on microwave measurement. So it's basically what it shows is that it's working. It's working. We are able to explain that there is something very massive, huge mass there. It's much more mass. That's why it's called hypermassive. Yeah? We don't know if it's a black hole, but it's compatible with being one because it's so massive, this thing, that the stars, the one which is called S2, which you, the one you have here, is making the orbit, the full orbit, in 16 years around this black hole. 16 years. And it is much, much, much farther than the remotest planet of our solar system is from the sun. Yeah? So it's going very fast. It's going at the big fraction of the speed of light. As a result of which you got even you get non-Newtonian effect, you got relativistic effect. For instance, you get this this redshift of the light. So there is confirmation of general relativity. So it's not only a Newtonian mechanics, it's also Einstein mechanics. And then it brings us to the second bit of the prize. So we've got less time to speak of the most important and more interesting aspect of it, which is always like that. So Penrose is the mathematician, theoretical physicist, who got the Nobel Prize. And what did he do, Penrose? So he's the relativist. He's the person who works with the general theory of relativity. He's known for several things. In particular, he's known for this triangle that you've seen before, the impossible triangle, which is an actual object. Yeah. So how can it be? Because it's an optical illusion, of course. So he actually didn't invent it, but he's the one who made it popular. He's famous as well for the Penrose tiling. You see him standing on one. The Penrose tiling is how you can make an aperiodic, five-fold symmetric crystal, something which never repeats. So very clever thing as well. It led to quasi-crystal and other things like that. Quantum consciousness. So one thing which is really nice about Penrose is really like outside of the mainstream. He has really personal ideas on how to do things. And he's one of these people who works on this idea that there is some quantum mechanical effect involved in the process of consciousness, for instance. And he relates the very small quantum mechanics to the very large special relativity with this kind of things. The kind of things that brought Joseph Sohn to madness. Yeah. So Penrose has a lot of very interesting hypotheses on that. For the singularity theorem, that's the one for which he got the Nobel Prize. I'm going to speak a bit about that. Twist of theories, and actually a lot, many things. We can never stop. Now let me show you something which is really nice that shows in one illustration the kind of, that's one book of Penrose there. That's one kind of way to look at it that is so simple, so straightforward, but it shows that really he has different way to look at it. He's putting here, I hope you can see, he's putting the different scales of distance and different scale of time on two axes. And he shows there, he's putting some side to side, so everybody has seen that, the orders of magnitude. And he shows where we are in terms of size, so we are in the middle, and where we are in terms of time. In terms of time, interestingly, we are very close to the age of the universe. So Penrose made this point, you can check there. He makes this point that we think that life is short and ephemeral, but actually, if you look at it as you should, which is for things that have a lot of different time scale, not in linear way, but using logarithmic scale, we see that actually we as human being, we essentially live as long as the universe itself. Yeah? We are a very stable structure that live very long. So it's very obvious, very simple, direct observation, but that has so much consequences and repercussions to it. So that illustrates very well the kind of things he does. Yeah, Penrose, very interesting person. Yeah, there is this statement that I'm not going to read in the interest of time, but where he emphasized that he himself can only work on things that he, if he understands them on his own, in his own particular way. He doesn't like to go on a problem like Bardeen, no? Attack the problem of superconductivity and solve it. He can only attack problem where he can bring his own way to look at it, which, by the way, is highly geometrical. He thinks a lot in terms of geometrical terms. There's this very beautiful drawing in all his books. I showed you one of them in this page there. So I started, he was a pure mathematician. He was working in algebraic geometry, I believe, and in Cambridge. And then he made this Denis Sciamma, who was a guy working on relativity. And Denis Sciamma, by the way, Penrose, everybody is famous in the Penrose family. He has a brother with a chess master. The other brother is, one is a physicist that we know very well in condensed matter for this long-range order. Lionel Penrose. His father was very famous as well. He's the guy who changed the name of eugenics. Yeah, he thought it was not appropriate. The grandfather was a famous Irish painter. So, very interesting family, full of very clever people. And through his brother, he got in contact with this Denis Sciamma, who told him that don't do math. It's pure math. It's not interesting. Come and work with cosmology. And Sciamma was the PhD advisor of someone very famous, Stephen Hawking. And that's how Penrose got interested into this problem of physics, relativity in particular, but also quantum mechanics, everything. So we mentioned Newton already, the Keplerian orbit. There was someone at the time of Newton, Laplace, who made a very simple observation. He said, okay, this idea of gravitation, then we can imagine that if we look at the escape velocity, which means at which velocity something cannot escape a closed orbit around the planet, you cannot expel it from the planet. So if in here you see that we have on the left hand side the kinetic energy, 1/2 mv² is equal to the potential energy of the gravitation as given by Newton. And for V in blue, if I put the speed of light, which is something we don't like to do, yeah, we don't like to see 1/2 mv². We like to see mc², not 1/2 mv². But Laplace knew nothing about that, of course, but still he knew about the speed of light. He didn't use the notation C, but still he put C there and he said, okay, so if I had a planet which has given mass big M, then if this planet at this radius R that I put on the other side, you rearrange this equation, you can do it in your head, I get this radius for which light itself will not be able to escape gravitation. And that's a black hole. So interestingly, in this 18th century, Laplace could already predict something like the black hole. So keep in mind this formula that you've got on the left-hand side, 2gm/c². We'll find it again, because interestingly, from this Newtonian understanding, we capture formulas that are obtained from the framework of modern physics, which is that now comes Einstein, and Einstein brings the realization that space and time are not what we think. That's not what we feel, actually, and that's not what we think it is in Newtonian mechanics. Space and time are related. So we've got this very important structure, which is the light cone, and this solid line that you see there. This is a so-called world line. So according to Einstein, we should not look at things that happen at a given time, but we should look at so-called events, which are points in space-time, with both space and time embedded together as part of the given structure. And then the way you measure distances in space-time is not Pythagoras, like x² + y² + z². It's instead to mix space and time. So now space and time, they are related together. We measure things in space-time by mixing space and time. And this quantity is a so-called relativistic invariant. It means that if you change your reference frame, that's what I'm doing here. You can measure different objects, different events, sorry, happening at different position and different time. This quantity is conserved. And let me show you, is conserved. The way to pass from one reference frame to the other is given by this Lorentz relation transformation. I put it there so that our physics students, if they are there, they see that it's connected to what we do in the lecture. But it's not important for us. What's important is something like this. Here you have an object in blue, that could be you, that's an observer, who is going through his business, which means he's passing through the points of his world line in red. And you see that all the other points that are events, so it could be, I don't know, something that explodes or some collision or something that observes, they are being distorted a lot. So it doesn't look at all like Galilean physics. We've got on this horizontal axis, we've got distance. On this vertical axis, we've got time. And you recognize this cone, which is the light cone. The very important thing that you can see already is that, so this horizontal line here is the present for us. Yeah, remember, this is time on the vertical axis, so this horizontal line is the present. And you see that some events, some points, so like this one, for instance, in your future, then you can go in the past, now it's in the past, and then you can go in the future again. So this is something really strong of relativity, special relativity. There is no notion of future and of absolute future and absolute past. Something can be in your future and then go in your past back and forth, as long as it is outside your light cone. You've got the same thing here, which was the same animation, is showing now how you see various events in space-time depending on your relative speed. If the resolution is high enough and your eyes are good enough as well, you can see that you are changing the speed, going left or right at relativistic speed. What is important in this figure is that you see that the light cone that we put on every of this object is preserved. The Lorentz transformation, you could say the transformation that preserves the light cone. It doesn't distort the light cone, unlike the distortion it does of everything. And the consequence of this is this very famous twin paradox that I'm sure you have heard about, that if you take two twins, so that's two young Einstein, and one of them stays, let's say, on the planet Earth, while the other is taking a trip, he's going on a rocket and goes very far, very fast, and then he's coming back, the guy who's coming back, he would have aged differently than the other guy. Actually, my drawing is not too good because it's not clear that this is a young Einstein and this is the white Einstein. The point is that this one is younger than this one, which is really strange because how can it be that you can be younger just because you don't move? This is something which is true. We observe it with particles, and it shows that we can travel in the future. Time travel is not a science fiction. It's true. You only need to go very far. Okay, we'll not go into the detail of why it's like that, but it's related to the way that the events, they can go in your past or in your future depending on the relative speed. So when the guy is going away, the things that were before in his past now are in his future. And if you look at the same phenomenon, but that's with acceleration, okay? Because you can see it's a bit artificial that you go at a given speed and then suddenly in one kick, you come back. You could do the same with acceleration, and then what happens is that your line goes smoothly from the past to the future. So no problem. But if you look at acceleration, again, there's this very nice case of the identically accelerated twins. So it's the same story, we've got mom and dad that are looking at two twins that are in two rockets that are distance X naught apart, and then they accelerate. So they go from zero to some acceleration. And then after a given time, they, at the same time as far as the people on Earth, as far as dad and mom are concerned, they stop accelerating. And then everything was symmetric. They were at rest together, the two twins, they accelerated the same. They accelerated for the same amount of time. They stopped accelerating at the same moment as far as dad and mom are concerned. But then when they did this, what they find is that one of the twins, the one on the right, is older than the one who is on the left. And also the distance between them is not the same as when it started. Even though the distance always was, everything was symmetric. Yeah? So we kind of distorted space-time just as a result of acceleration. And that was a very strange effect, but very easy to understand. That was what Einstein called the happiest thought of his life. You see, there's a happy Einstein there. The realization that when something accelerates, if you accelerate with it, then you remove the effect of gravitation. So gravitation is an effect of the curvature of space-time. That was the big insight of Einstein. So we'll not go through the detail of this equation, but basically it explains gravitation. It explains things like we shouldn't put the clock very high because the clock that is high is ticking faster than the one that is at the bottom. The time for the person who is at the feet of Big Ben is going slower than the time of the clock there because of this fact that the gravitation is weaker when you are high than when you are close, right? And the space-time is curving differently. Of course, the deviation is very small, so it doesn't result in things that you can measure. It doesn't explain why you will miss your meeting. Okay, a few words about Schwarzschild. Schwarzschild is someone who solved the Einstein equation that I didn't have time to discuss, but basically Einstein couldn't solve the equation. He could write them down. He could relate space and the curvature of space-time to the mass and these kind of things. He couldn't solve the equation. And it was for this guy, Schwarzschild, who was on the front. He was a German scientist who was in World War One on the front. He solved the things for a particular case with spherical symmetry. And then he found that there were divergences in his so-called metric, which is the way that we relate proper time or the invariant there. Where's my mouse again? So that's the thing which doesn't change when you go from one reference frame to the other. In this general case of curve space-time, that's the metric, the Schwarzschild metrics, and you observe that there were divergences. And these divergences is so-called Schwarzschild radius, which is this formula. And here, if you remember that I told you to keep in mind this formula of before, it's exactly the escape velocity that was found by Laplace. Yeah? This is very beautiful because there is an effect of Newtonian mechanics that appears in this general relativistic context. So these divergences, they've been looked at by a lot of people, by Hilbert, many mathematicians, because the math was so strange, this tensor of things, that very few people at the time, very few physicists were able to follow. So mathematicians like Hilbert started to get into the game. And it was understood that there was something really fundamental in the fabric of space-time. There can happen the so-called singularity, some all in space-time. So points where space and time behave differently. And that brings this guy, Oppenheimer. I couldn't find a picture of the student with whom he did the work. But Oppenheimer, he studied what happens when you have the collapse of this Schwarzschild solution with spherical symmetry. He predicted the black hole. That was the work of Oppenheimer. But it was highly mathematical, highly simplified. Remember this Kao model of the physicist, that everything is a sphere. You can approximate a Kao by a sphere. And it was thought that maybe it was very beautiful mathematically, but it was just like an exercise. It was not realistic. And this is where come Penrose. I'm going to the end of my talk now. I'm showing you the paper for which Penrose got the Nobel Prize. Three-page paper, not even three pages, yeah, because lots of reference. A lot of reference from the previous papers. It's basically a two pages paper, of which in 1965, what Penrose did here, basically, that's why he got the Nobel Prize. He demonstrated that the solution of Oppenheimer, which says that there is this instability and that the things collapse in space-time and makes a black hole, he demonstrated that it's true regardless of the geometry. Yes, yeah? It could be not a perfect sphere, but something which is with wobbled or is elliptical or is deformed, which certainly is the case in a real physical context. We never got perfect symmetry. There are also solutions with rotating black holes, but anyway, he showed that based on topological arguments, the space-time is curving in a way that is trapping, regardless of the spatial geometry, is trapping things to go into this singularity, into this black hole. So that's the contribution of Penrose in this paper, which was called, I don't see it on the screen, or maybe I don't see it. It was called, in case you don't see the title, it was called Gravitational Collapse and Space-Time Singularities. And I took a few bits. The paper is actually almost, we could read it together now because it's so short. Every quote that you take is relevant. So he says that general situation with regard to a spherical symmetry body is well known. That's the Oppenheimer solution with Schneider. He says that deviation from spherical symmetry is important because, of course, otherwise it's just mathematical approximation. And here he introduced this concept of trapped surface. This is a topological concept that shows that the way that space-time will curve, that's what is shown in this figure there. You see that space-time, I told you, when you in flat space-time, it means spatial relativity, when you go from one reference frame to the other, the cones of light are always the same. They're always pointing the same direction. You don't change your light cone. You change your time and space, but not the light cone. But when you curve space-time, then this is changing. And you see that when you are approaching the singularity, so that's the event horizon there, that's the singularity in between. The event horizon is when there is this this Schwarzschild divergence. And you see that your space-time cone is tilted in a way that now light indeed is trapped. It's not trapped in the very naive way of Laplace that the gravitation is so strong that you cannot escape through the escape velocity. It's trapped in a very beautiful, deep, fundamental way that light itself is kind of trapped like that. You see that you cannot see as an observer if you are not in the black hole, you cannot see it because light itself is, by the very geometry of space-time, is confined to be there. And when you are inside, then it's everything is pointing inside the singularity. So what Penrose did basically is to show that, and that's, we'll read again the denomination of the Nobel Committee, is to show that the singularity is a robust, is a true, is a physical thing. The singularity of space-time is a real thing. It's not a mathematical artifact of the Einstein equation. Okay, we'll not discuss that again because I don't have time, but it's very relevant. It's revealing things of how Penrose is doing the thing. This is a space-time diagram, so we've got space on the horizontal axis and time on the vertical, but with a conformal mapping. Conformal, it means that it's preserving the angle and it's bringing infinity into the picture. And that's a so-called Penrose diagram that shows how Penrose is able to visualize or make some picture of this space-time thing, bringing the infinite past and infinite future inside the diagram. And this is a so-called black hole solution where you see there is a singularity. So there is a point where the time stops. In a black hole, the time stops, or it can become only space. So that's interesting to imagine something where there is no time. Okay, something really interesting, and I'm really getting to the end now, don't worry, is that Penrose got the prize with the two other people who certainly deserve it, because again, to see the stars orbiting like this is really nice, really fantastic. But it's very sad as well because Stephen Hawking didn't get the Nobel Prize. And Stephen Hawking is one of these people that is a real injustice, didn't get it because, well, first, the way he could work, given his personal disability, but also the insight, the breakthrough of Hawking. And you know about this Hawking radiation and the way he brought thermodynamics. But what did he do, Hawking, basically, is to show that the singularity theorem, which is the inescapability of the equation of Einstein to lead into a singularity, he applied it not to the black hole, like Penrose, he applied it to the universe as a whole, to the Big Bang and the Big Crunch. And that gives a completely new importance to the concept of a black hole, because you could say, okay, it's very far, it's at the center of the galaxy, but who cares? But we care because it shows that basically this singularity theorem of Penrose, that now we call the Hawking-Penrose or Penrose-Hawking singularity theorem, is actually the key, the theoretical key to know about the way the universe began and the origin of matter or time or space of everything. That's the contribution of Hawking. But he died a couple of years ago before the Nobel Prize was awarded. So that's a big, not injustice, but it's really sad in a way that Hawking missed the prize. So let's conclude. Let's read again at the official denomination. So half of it was to Penrose for the discovery that black hole formation is a robust prediction of general relativity. So now let's put back in context this three-page physical review paper where it shows that mathematically the singularity is not some mathematical artifact of particular solution. It's something which is there regardless of what you do, something which is robust in the topological sense. And the other half of the prize shared between two people, two competing groups, for the discovery of supermassive compact objects. Remember, don't see the black hole there because we don't know. It could be something else. It could be in particular a lot of black holes. We know the mass, yeah, because of the orbit. We know it's very heavy. It cannot be a star. But it could be a lot of black holes. And then it starts to be detailed. Yeah, they explain why it's a single black hole, they think. But who cares? Even if it's five black holes, who cares? And so they observe this H2 or SO2. Interestingly, they both independently gave almost the same name to the star, which is confirming general relativity with splendid accuracy, which is very beautiful again, because it shows that this theory of Einstein that he made based on aesthetical argument was able to describe everything. Okay, so that's my last slide. This is something I would like to say to our students, that last year's Nobel Prize is next year's final exam. So now life carries on. People go back to their own stuff. It was very nice to know about it. Everybody should know about it, of course. Nobel Prize awards, what is the most important, not the preceding year anymore according to Nobel's will, but according to the previous career. It takes time to decide if something is important. And I hope it was, well, a bit entertaining regarding the gossip part and a bit enlightening or informative regarding the specific of this year's Nobel Prize. This being said, if we didn't disconnect, if I'm not speaking to myself, which is always something that I fear, when I give these talks, I will give back the chair to our chairman so that he can tell us. So is someone there? Are you there, Camilo?
Thank you very much, Fabrice, for this very interesting talk. So far, I don't see any questions. So,
which means okay, that people are paying attention. So it's good, actually.
I've got the first one. It's, do you have a favorite Nobel winner?
Myself, I've got the favorite people who should have got the Nobel Prize but didn't get it. I think that Anne-Marie Brown should have got the Nobel Prize, maybe with the people who did this radio astronomy, this 94 Nobel Prize. for radio astronomy, Humphrey Brown should have been there because he also did things that are really genius, insightful, personal. He really went against everybody else. And that's when you are an iconoclast, yeah, when you break the foundation of everybody that you really deserve the prize. In this way, Penrose deserves it because he's really unlike any other theoretical physicist. I believe most people who are trendy have different opinion than him. He believes that string theory, for instance, is not good. Yeah? While most people would say that the future are hope for unified theory, string theory. So he has very different opinion than everybody else, and not only for the quantum consciousness. Yeah, Penrose. So in this sense, it's very interesting. As for people who really got the prize, well, not really. No, I would say that maybe Heisenberg. I like a lot Heisenberg. Maybe because I don't like so much Schrödinger.
Mm-hmm. So we have another one. It's are the Nobel Prize winners, are they allowed to spend the money in any way they want, or can they use it only for research purposes?
No, in any way they want. Some people give the money, yeah, away. And some don't. Feynman, for instance, he bought a house by the sea with his money.
Mm-hmm. And what do you think about?
I don't remember whom, but there's one case of a guy who got so destitute in the United States that he had to sell his gold medal. He had to sell the medal to pay for the bills at the hospital. Mm-hmm. So he did something with the money already.
What do you think about the rule that dead people cannot receive the prize?
Which rule? Because they are dead, or the free people max rule, or both?
The rule that you cannot get the prize if you are dead.
If you are dead. But I think it's good because there are so many people, so many important people that did important things that we wouldn't know where to start. Yeah, we have to award Newton, Maxwell, Leibniz, Faraday. I mean, there would be no enough prizes. Yeah, and what for? There is the zeitgeist. Yeah, we can, as a society, we can only judge our contemporary. We cannot judge the work of Newton, or not anymore, it wouldn't be fair. Mm-hmm. I mean, the thing which isn't fair is when people die. I mean, Hawking died, so it's too late. Gandhi died before getting the prize. He would have gotten it eventually, but he died before. I was speaking of Glauber. Glauber got it for quantum optics, basically because quantum optics deserved the prize, certainly. And to give it to whom? Valls, who is the guy who should have gotten it, certainly, or Mandel as well, they all died. So you give it to whom? Well, certainly not to Sudarshan, seems to be the rule. And Sudarshan is dead.
One.
Sudarshan is dead, so he will not get the prize for sure. So we'll not get him being wronged any further. But interestingly, Sudarshan is the guy who predicted the tachyon. The tachyon is the particle that goes faster than the speed of light. And if you look again at our space-time diagram, if you can go outside of your light cone, then you can go back in time. So maybe Sudarshan will get it with the tachyon by going back in time.
We also have a question about the acceleration. So if acceleration has an effect on time, could it not be possible that all or most calculation on the speed and acceleration of objects far away from us can be inaccurate?
No, because it has an effect on space-time, not only on time, because that's the point. Time by itself means nothing in relativity. Yeah? You have to take into account space-time. These things people take into account, of course, when they make calculation, relativistic calculation, all the general relativistic effects are taken into account when it's needed. So this mystery, like why there is a missing mass, where is the dark matter and all this stuff, of course, this is taken into account. The point is, it's difficult to see relativistic effect. To see relativistic effect, you need to have black holes or pulsars or this kind of really heavy things, or things that go very fast, which means they should be very small. So elementary particles, like in CERN, we see relativistic effect.
Mm-hmm. We have a question about the accelerated twins. So it's not clear how they can age differently when the distance was kept the same. If you can explain further on this.
Not only the distance, everything was kept the same. Hang on. So I hope this question doesn't come from a physics student of level 6, because they should answer. They should be able to answer this question by themselves. Everything is kept the same. The time from moments that point of view, which means from the people who are observing in their reference frame where they symmetry. Because the point is that if you are in one of these two rockets, now that's the point of time not existing. Yeah? The time is different for all of them, which means that all the moment that they see them accelerating, starting to accelerate at the same time, and they will see them run out of fuel or stop accelerating at the same time. For the girl on the right or the boy on the left, looks like a girl and a boy, this happens at different time. Yeah, so the girl stops accelerating before the boy, and that's why she will age differently. So that's the point of relativity. It's very counterintuitive. It looks like paradoxical to the point that it doesn't make sense, it's illogical. But if you look at the equations, I mean, it's very easy. You take the space-time diagram, you trace the world line of these two ships, so their position in space and time, in three reference frames. In the reference frame of mom and dad, in the reference frame of the rocket, as they're traveling, and at the end, in the reference frame of the rocket that goes at their final speed when they stop accelerating. And you see indeed how this thing transforms because of this skewness. So you see that the girl, she jumps. The point is that in the rocket that is in the final velocity reference frame, the girl is always in the future of the boy. And that's why the boy, when he's looking at her, he sees her older. But that's really an enlightening case, this one, because it's the one that connects special relativity to gravitational or to general relativistic effect. That's one of the tenets of general relativity, that locally space-time is flat.
Okay, thank you. We have a question that is building on the previous one about the acceleration. So I'm going to read it. It's quite long. So let's see if I can make sense of it. Could we not be unaware of sources similar to gravity affecting objects so far away that we cannot be confident in saying how things are relative to each other? And could we not be unaware of sources similarly to gravity affecting objects so far away that we cannot be confident on how things are relative to each other and only to ourselves, as it might not be visible to us?
Well, of course, we can never be completely sure of anything, yeah? But you can have, that's what they call the beyond any reasonable doubt. If you look at the accuracy that we have to describe the motion of a star, which is 65,000 light years away from us, takes 65,000 years for the light from the center of a galaxy in Sagittarius A star to reach us. If we look at this over 20 years, yeah, they make it. The point is, going so fast, this star around its black hole, around its center, around its Kepler orbit, that they had the time to image the entire rotation. Yeah? They did it for 20 years, the accumulated data. And it matched perfectly. It agrees with the general relativity with utmost accuracy till the last possible digits. Actually, I always say to the students that the QED, quantum electrodynamics, is the most accurate theory we have because it agrees on the, I don't remember which decimal. But as I was reading Penrose, I don't remember where, he makes the opposite statement that general relativity is the most accurate theory in terms of how well the prediction works with the measurements. So how can we doubt it? How can we doubt that it's correct when it's working so well? It explains everything. It explains the gravitational redshift. It explains the period. It explains the trajectory. I would say that we are fairly convinced that it works well. Now, if there are other things, of course, we can always imagine that there are other things. And there are unanswered questions. As far as Penrose is concerned, he's saying that, I'll quote him from memory, but he's saying something like, and he made this statement at the time he got the Nobel Prize, with this recent one. He's saying that the understanding of singularity is the major problem of modern astrophysics. That's to understand the singularity. So in his mind, he's not well understood. So. I mean, if this person who is asking worries that everything has been explained, it's not like that. And there is a lot of things to figure out.
So what happens to the light that gets trapped into this object? What happens to this energy, this information that cannot go away? Mm-hmm.
So light, I like to say that we shouldn't think in terms of what happens to light itself, because the proper time of light is zero. Yeah? You know that if you go in a reference frame that goes at the speed of light, your proper time vanishes. So as soon as you are emitted, that's the time dilation effect, right? As soon as the photon is emitted, is absorbed right away. A photon that is emitted by one of these stars 60,005 years ago, and that we detect now, this morning, it took 65,000 years from our point of view, from someone which is on Earth looking at this photon. But But from the photon itself, it's been emitted right at the same moment that it's been absorbed, because it's going at the speed of light. If you would go at the tiny, tiny, tiny fraction below the speed of light, the journey would take half a second, right? And at the speed of light, it takes no time at all. So we cannot speak of what happens to a photon. A photon has no time, no proper time. Its proper time is zero by definition. So we can speak instead of what happens to a particle, to an observer that goes into the black hole. And this is also an interesting thing. The point is that you don't see anything when you pass the event horizon. For you, there's nothing weird happening, because again, locally, your space-time is bounding from the point of view of someone who is far. But when you go there, you don't see anything. And you'll never see anything because the time is stretching. Yeah, this is the so-called spaghettification process, where you are being elongated in space and time. So your time is becoming slower and slower, and you will never find yourself being trapped at the singularity. So you are there falling forever, in sort of speed. The point is that you are beyond the access from someone who is outside of the black hole. Someone of the black hole cannot come and grab you by the hand and pull you out. Once you're inside the event horizon, that's forever that you are falling toward the singularity. Hawking and Penrose, they made a lot. Hawking wrote a lot of popular books. Penrose much less, but Hawking, you know, he even made a movie, like a brief history of time. Yeah, there's the book, there's a movie as well, which is quite interesting. There's a lot of discussion there of what happens when you cross the event horizon. So I invite you to have a look from the master themselves, straight from the arse more.
So let's see if there are more questions. I don't see them popping out. So I'll just give some time, just in case someone has a last minute question. But in the meantime,
waiting for this last minute question, I will say two things that Penrose said when he was interviewed after getting the Nobel Prize. One is that he thinks it's very good that you get the Nobel Prize late in time, at the end of your life, because he was saying that it was very sad for Hawking, it was too late for him, but himself was very happy to get it at the end, because like this, his activity has not been spoiled by this. And if you get it too young, maybe you start to do something else, like entertainment, show, I don't know, politics maybe. That's one interesting statement. Maybe he was thinking of Josephson. He was saying that he knew some people for whom it was a catastrophe to get it young. And the other thing is that they asked him about movies, and he said that he liked very much Space Odyssey from Kubrick. He thought it was really good. But on the other hand, this interstellar movie, where you know there is this gravitation effect and the guy who grows very old because he's far from the black hole, he said that this one he didn't like at all. He thought it was rubbish. It was nonsense, which is particularly interesting because for this movie, there was Kip Thorne, one of the Nobel Prize that we mentioned for the LIGO collaboration, was serving as the technical advisor. And he even wrote a book there where he tries to justify that everything in Interstellar movie is based on good science. But from Penrose, so you see, he's really in opposition with the mainstream people. He thinks that the Interstellar is rubbish.
Mm-hmm. So I don't see any further questions. So I would like to thank you, Fabrice, for this very interesting talk. These cosmological topics are always very fascinating, very marvelous results. So thank you very much for explaining. And so I would like to not only thank you, but also invite you for our next presentation of the IOP, in our next lecture, which will be on November 18th. Will be delivered by Dr. Amir Rahmani on vortex dancing with structured light. So a bit continuing on sort of this topic of things revolving around things that we cannot see. So it would be very interesting. And thank you everyone for attending. And I hope we'll see you next month for our next lecture.
Thank you.